गुरु कृपा केवलम। नमस्ते एंड वेलकम एवरीवन टू सत्संग टुडे। सदगुरु श्री मुजी बाबा की जय। Okay, we have a question. So, are self-help books or TED Talks, YouTube videos better and more important than other information in the world? Some YouTube videos or movies or books other than non-duality knowledge open up my mind. They give me a different perspective. I strongly feel that they are helpful and contain amazing knowledge. Can you clear to me that even this type of mind-blowing or opening knowledge is not necessary? Why shouldn't I worry about these things? Yeah, it's very... I used to love watching TED Talks. When they started becoming available on YouTube many years ago, maybe 15 years ago or something. Yeah, I saw a lot of them. It's very good. It's very good. So, I can understand where the confusion is coming from. We are confusing phenomenal knowledge with self-knowledge. You see? And what you are being pointed to in satsang is that which is beyond any sort of intellectual conceptualization. You see? Because we make the mistake, especially in Advaita, that we confuse some sort of intellectual knowledge to be self-knowledge. You see, if you take intellectual knowledge to be just intellectual knowledge, it's fine. You see, but if you make it about yourself, you see, that is when the confusion comes. So, whether you call this a play, a game, a dream, or reality, you see, now, whatever you think you know about the appearance, you see, as long as you're clear that it's just about the appearance, it's about this game, it's about this dream, it's about this play, you see, or whatever term you use for that, it is fine. But if you confuse it to be, let's see, if you confuse it to be about yourself, you see, then at best what you could be saying is that you're using some mental intellectual knowledge to describe the state of one particular body mind, and as long as you are convinced that that is you, then that is fine. You see, then that is fine. But if there already is an inkling that I am not just this, I want to see in reality what is my truth, which is beyond this universe, beyond birth and death, beyond time and space, then if we are expecting that in our intellect some answer will be there which will truly convey what myself is, then that is the confusion. So self-knowledge cannot be a perceptual knowledge nor a conceptual knowledge. You see? It's like, if you like watching football, as I do, you see, then you know the rules of the game. Okay, this is offside, this is goalkeeper, he's allowed to hold the ball with his hand, everybody else isn't. You see, this is a defender, this is a midfielder, this is a forward. You see? So you're talking about the game. But if you start applying that to yourself, you see, that's when the confusion comes. That am I a forward or a midfielder or a defender? I know it sounds strange, this example that I'm taking, but this is what we do. We've taken the rules of this game and applied it to ourselves. You see? So if you feel that this is the entirety of you, which is your phenomenal existence, you see, then that is fine. When we come to satsang, I have often said that there's only one prerequisite, you see, which is to be a little open. If you're open to the possibility that you are not an object in this world, if you're open to the possibility that you are not an object in this world, even if it seems like it is too much to say, maybe the world is just an objective appearance within me, that's all right. You don't even have to be convinced about that. But if you are convinced that you are an object in this world, and the world, phenomenal nature of the world, completely captures your true nature, then of course, then that is more than enough to hear. In fact, as far as phenomenal things go, things like this are very good. It's not a bad thing to immerse yourself in, as opposed to many other things you could be doing. So, you see? But it's a question of level confusion. If you are speaking about self-knowledge, Atma-gyan, you see, then to expect it to come out of some intellectual conclusion, you see, then that is not possible. You see? So, don't confuse the rules of this game with the rules of self-knowledge. I go to work over there, you have to read up. So just the other day I was reading up about design trends. You see, what are the top design trends in the world right now? You see, is that contrary to something? No, because I'm not confusing it with myself. You see, it's just rules of the game. Rules of this, whether you call it game, dream, leela, maya, doesn't matter. So there isn't any contradiction. Of course, the mind can say this or that. You see? So the last question that you made is very important, because you put three question marks there, so it apparently is bothering you a lot, and you capitalize the why. You see? Why shouldn't I worry about these things? And we'll get into making fun of the why question in some time. But it is apparent in your questioning and force behind the question that the central protagonist in this why shouldn't I worry about these things? You see, if you're clear that I is an object in this world, and it was born and it will die, and that's all there is to it, you see, then don't have to, in fact, you don't have to worry about satsang. You see, just worry about those things. But when there is an inkling that there is something more about my reality, you see, then the words of satsang are for this self-discovery, self-knowledge. Everyone will tell you about their perspective in the world, and what is right and what is wrong and what is good and what is bad. All of these things you'll get from everywhere. It's only when you come to satsang that you are pushed beyond your intellect. You see? But it is only for those who have this inkling, who have beyond an inkling actually a longing for this non-phenomenal truth. You see? If somebody comes to me at work and says, okay, what should I be working on today? I'm not going to be saying, but who are you? You see, because that's not what they are asking for. That's not what they are open about. You see, so I can say, maybe you can work on this project or look at this. You see? So, but if you say that what I truly, truly want is to discover myself, is to recognize myself, self-realization, then I'm telling you that whatever you fill into your intellect and whatever perceptual experiences you may be having are not going to describe your reality, are not going to interpret your reality. Okay. She looks a bit worried. Thank you, my dear, thank you. Sometimes what happens with spiritual seekers is we try to spiritualize our knowledge of the world and we try to intellectualize our self-knowledge. And you go to the world and the world says this has to be done, this has to be. Then we start. You see? But who am I to do these things? And you come to satsang and I say, but who are you in reality? What are you representing? And I, but isn't an understanding of the world important? So, like Guruji says, whatever you give to the mind, it is only going to mix mud in it. If I make you the best chocolate cake, but if you give it to the mind, it's only going to mix mud in it. So what does that mean? It means that no personal intervention is needed in the words of satsang. You see, how does this apply to me? You see, am I really understanding this? How will I live now? These are usual confusions which are still coming from a false representation of you. You see? How do I balance my life? We were just talking about it after the broadcast yesterday.
But I did not ask it for all of this. No? Did I ask it for a mind?
Huh?
I did not ask it for all of this.
Who I?
Whatever, whoever is trying to solve.
So if you are already happy with the supposed I, then there is no use answering you. It's just like a lamentation, but I didn't ask for this. And this is a mood which will go. Tomorrow you will say, this is all that I want. You see? So this kind of mood, sometimes like tantrums and sometimes like, you see, like that. This is the realm of the changing. So, when you say, but I didn't ask for this, all this, who am I, why is it troubling me so much? You see? Then don't trouble yourself. I never force anyone to come to satsang. You see? Don't trouble yourself.
Put them on the mind, like you said, whatever we give to mind,
yeah. Of course, the mind won't like it.
No, but this is what has been given to me. As a
to whom?
To me.
To whom? Me is?
I am the one who is using the mind.
Yes. As who? Who is this I? This body is using it?
Not body.
Okay. Who gave what to whom? Who gave what to whom? This is given to me. Who gave it? Who oppressed you in this way? You see? Who is the oppressor and who is the oppressed? it is given to me and now I have to live with it. What is the point? She said, who is it? You know any of that?
Mind is there with me.
There is mind, which means that there is a bundle of thoughts which keeps appearing. Okay.
So now, why now we should put blame on the mind? See, if I have given one peg, and this is what I have.
Let me tell you another metaphor. You see, now suppose you had a child. Child was given to you, agreed. Okay. Now child started growing up. At 3 year old, child makes up many stories. You see? Now suppose that you are such a loving parent that you're buying every story from the mind, from the child. You see? The child is saying, I met Chota Bhim yesterday. And Chota Bhim said, come with me to Gokul, so I'm going, father, today. You say, okay, yes, good. Like that. So all that is being reminded is that when we take this child's representation to be the truth, you see, that is the process of mixing mud in reality. So to remind you that what it is saying about your reality, you see, it doesn't truly represent it, is to remind you of the contamination, the identity, the adulteration that consciousness seems to be playing with. You see? So then will you say, but this child was given to me, I have to listen to it now, I have to go to Gokul with Chota Bhim. So let it be, let it say, but you have the power, not as what you think you are, but as consciousness, to not buy into these stories about yourself. You also have the power of inner insight to see what you are and how these stories don't apply to you. But if you keep going with this perspective, which this tiny child in your mind is saying, then obviously it won't like it. No, if you say the child is lying, obviously it's going to throw a tantrum, and you start representing that tantrum. Is not going to be in service to you. So yes, it is your own creation, it is your own child, but it is not telling you the truth about yourself. But if you continue to be the lawyer for this mind, then obviously you will not be happy as to how your client is being represented. Now the fun part is the why question. Why was I given this mind then? Firstly, who gave to who, that's a different thing. And also there was a big why with capital WHY earlier. Now let's ask a why question. If you can tell me any why answer to anything. Let's start with the simplest, the basic. You see, the basic is what? That I exist. You see? Because you can't say anything exists unless you exist. When you don't exist, there is no claim like that can be made anyway. You see? Now, who can tell me why you exist? Before anything else, we can reason into and say this is why this happened and things like this. You see? Who can say, tell me the truth, why you exist? Huh?
Because I'm already there.
No, why? Why there? Not are you there or not? Why are you there? Tell me the reason, why are you there?
A reason may be there, but I don't know.
That's what I'm saying. If we don't even know that, what other why can we know? All other reason, intellectualization that we have, oh, the world is like this because this happened and these politicians did this and this is what, you see, all this reasoning that we put, you see, is on something that we can claim only after our existence. We are claiming that something exists, you see, but that is shining only in the light of our existence. I exist. When you don't exist, there is nothing, you see. So the substratum itself is your existence. Can you tell me why you exist? Before we can reason into any of, like, why do I have a fingernail? But first, can you tell me why you have a body? You see? So it's like, why is the world like this? Why does God do this to me? All of this thing. If you feel like you can have a valid why for anything, especially your existence, you see, then let's get into resolving any other why questions. You see? So this why is the biggest sham and the biggest oppressor of humanity. Why? That's why you say this, no? Tiger got to hunt, bird got to fly, man got to ask himself why. Tiger got to sleep, bird got to land, man got to tell himself he understands. Because we feel like our life is pointless unless we understand. So this why. But we don't know any why. All our reasoning that we think, you know, is all nonsense. It's all level confusion. You see? If it feels like it applies to our reality, as long as it is worldly, you say this is the rules of my computer game, it's fine. You see, this is the way that this game is played, this is how karma is applied in this realm. Okay, fine. Believe it, it's fine. You see? But if you tell me this applies to your reality, you see, you cannot point to that one that is caught up in this game. You see, you cannot tell me, you cannot show me that one. You can only presume it. So this is the point. So, and scientists, philosophers, everybody been trying to solve this why question about why existence for thousands and thousands of years. And where are we now? No two sages will also agree on why. Why this creation? One will say, what creation? Forget about it. Another will say, it's the Leela. Krishna is playing the play, you see, just to enjoy. You see? Another will say, it is for evolution. Consciousness wants to go higher and higher. You see? Another will say, it's only when the manifest appears, then I can taste my own love. You see? All very nice answers, but all nonsense. Including when I say play, leela, all nonsense. You see, it's just that in this expression, this seems like the most viable. You see? Why all nonsense? Because it's like consciousness or the self, the absolute, wanted to play, wanted to experience itself in this way, wanted to, you see? And what are we told, especially in spirituality? How can you want? That is desire. You see? So if the absolute self also had a want, then we should also want. You see? So it is just our attempts to fit reality, to fit what is, into this tiny instrument called the intellect. As I say that, it is often said that God created man in his image, but actually what we are trying to do is create God in our image, a human image. So there must be a reason why God created this world. Why must there be a reason? What is the reason for that? Why must there be a reason? Because everything is based on reason, is it? We haven't even been able to resolve what reason is and how it functions. Great philosophers have come and gone. Immanuel Kant tried to write this whole critique on reason. What were his conclusions? All refuted by now. You see? So if you're looking at something, look deeper. Look really deeply with full courage and honesty. Because otherwise, you'll just settle for these very timid conclusions which you will think are very worthwhile but are nothing. They've been had, the same discussions, the same conversations have happened for hundreds of thousands of years. You read Bhagwan's book, Talks with Ramana. What are the questions in that? Same. 100 years ago, no difference has come. Same question, same answer. You see? You read Socrates, you read Plato, you read the Bhagavad Gita, you read the Upanishads, you read all of that. What are the questions saying? Same. Why? How do I run my life? How can I deal with my responsibilities? Same. Thousands of years ago, 100 years ago, we talked to Ramana. Today, sorry if I'm sounding as if I'm ranting. That is not the intent. It's just to shake you out of this kind of very limiting sort of why me? You see, because when we say why, mostly we are saying why me? When will I get it? Why? This is so tiny, so small.
The reason why we keep on asking the same question because we also feel like we are just circling around truth, just asking these things. So we just want to leave it every side aside and then come to the truth. When we try to do that, we don't go anywhere.
Yeah, so that's what I'm trying to tell you.
So that's what I want to ask now. Yeah. Okay, so I'm ready to just leave it aside because I don't want to circle anymore.
Yes.
Enough is enough.
Yes.
And like you said, and Father also said, no precondition. I'm not in a good mood today also.
Yeah.
So
we couldn't guess.
So I'm actually not feeling well also. Everything is
everything.
In this state, as is, just
yeah.
Now I want to see
yeah.
The truth.
So, very good. So, you let go of all of this you said. I just want to leave it aside. I don't want to circle the truth anymore. I want to be the truth. You see, I don't want to circle around it. Now what all have you left? Every idea about the truth you left?
Yeah.
Every idea about the truth. Now leave the one that left it also. Leave the one that left it also. That's it. That is the truth. See, now it'll knock on the door. Means, sir, can I come back in, please? I'll be your friend. What we say in Hindi? Aage badho bhaiya. Let it come and let it go. You see? Don't be the finder. Don't be the discoverer. Don't be someone who has got the truth. Don't take yourself to be anything at all. Even nothing. Either louder or closer, one of the two.
I can't be this way, I won't know what will happen.
Yeah. Like, I can't be so open and empty. You see? What is the best thing that could happen in this world? What if I'm so open and empty that enlightenment comes and goes? It came and said hello, and I was so open and empty, it also said okay, bye bye. Then what else? Maybe my soulmate, she comes and she waves at me, But I'm so open and empty. I'm just like, what could you miss out on, you know, in this open and emptiness? No, that's what you're looking at. So for a spiritual seeker, of course, biggest fear is, what if enlightenment came to say hello, but I was too empty? I can't stay like this. I have to be able to grab enlightenment when it comes. See? What are the other fears? What could you lose? Best relationship, soulmate is coming. She's saying, hello, Nitin. And here finally, we waited many lifetimes to meet. And you're just like, okay. Like, okay, bye, I don't want to talk to you. Is that what you could miss out on? What if? Best business opportunity, you know? Idea is coming. Your company will be a unicorn tomorrow. Just get back to work. You see, you can do in the freedom later. You see? It's coming. And you're just so open and empty. Now I really messed up my life. What is the worst that could happen? And by the way, also the other question to ask is, when we tried to control it, how has it gone? Very well, exceedingly great. It's highly unlikely. For most in satsang, he felt like, already feel like somewhere life was not playing well enough. Mostly it is suffering that brings us to satsang, supposedly. So, how, like the Americans would say, when you trusted the mind, how did that work out for you?
Oh, it's promising.
You see, it's promising, like, yeah, now I'll be good. I'll be your good servant, I'll tell you good things, I'll be your best friend. You see? The other form is like this, so I was like, but why are we always attacking the mind? Why are we all? Isn't mind consciousness also? Yes, it is. Of course, it is consciousness. It is also God, you see. But so are pickpockets. Pickpockets also consciousness. No, go give your wallet to them. So these are just protestations, the lamentations coming from the mind. But they seem quite harmless at some level. But the point is that if you buy seriously into the representation they are making out of you, then that is only what is called identity or suffering. Now, in a way, we may think that what we want is to continue to have this identity, and yet always be happy or no suffering or just be at peace. But this doesn't play out like that. This doesn't play out like that. But in a way, your question was different. Your question. So if I just, what is it? If I just stay like this, will I be missing
enough.
Out?
It's not enough. I don't know what will happen. So yeah. It's not enough. It's not.
And what if, okay, what would that be that has to happen for it to be enough?
It has to be good consciousness.
It has to be good consciousness. You have to elaborate on that.
Well, I was looking just now, it was forming an idea of specific events, behaviors, thoughts that should appear. So, then it's,
So what am I asking you to do? Just remain open, remain empty. So what is the fear? Suppose Mr. Good Consciousness was coming. You see, if I was just so open, you see, that Mr. Good Consciousness also came and went. And it was coming with all the best feelings, all the best experiences, all the best interactions, no confusion, all bliss. You see, all of that. You see? But what I'm suggesting is that in our openness, then all of this can continue to come and go, but you remain untouched, you remain unharmed. I'm just introducing you to the lottery ticket you have already won. You see, like Guruji also sometimes, no? Because it's like, what if I miss out? You see, but what are you being pointed to? I'm telling you, you are the Supreme Self. You see, but you are saying, but what can I be as a person? But you are the Supreme Self, the one that all the scriptures are about. But will I have a happy life? You are the Supreme Self. You see? Because I can feel like Ananta is just asking me to let go of everything, then I'll have such a dead, insipid life. You see? Because we have this false idea that in our grasping, we'll grasp the good things. You see? But it is only in our letting go. Guruji says that if you chase the world, then it runs from you. If you stop chasing the world, then it comes and kisses you. You see? But we have been taught in a way, our conditioning has been in a way that we have to grab it, get it. But grasping is suffering. If you don't take Ananta's words for it, then at least take the Buddha's words for it. The whole of Buddhism, the central tenet is this idea that grasping is suffering. So openness, emptiness is not grasping. Okay, what is it that you can have forever? You see, suppose you had something really nice. Now, all of us have seen that everything that comes in the realm of perception, it also goes, isn't it? So when we get attached to something which is phenomenal, then when it goes, what happens to us? We suffer. You see? But what is it symptomatic of? It is not symptomatic of the truth. It is symptomatic of attachment. You cannot suffer without grasping. You see? So, and what can you attach to? Can you attach to the non-phenomenal? Can you attach to the non-phenomenal? You can only attach to something phenomenal. So, if you are crying, something phenomenal is gone, you see, then even intellectually that is not logical, because would you rather be attached to it longer? So when the suffering comes, when it goes, will be much more. So if it is the apparent grief which is coming from the loss of an attachment, actually it should be celebrated that I was attached to something which was going to go anyway, but now it did me a favor and only lasted this long. I know, it sounds utopian maybe. It sounds utopian. So where is it gone missing? If my grace is needed, means it's not there now. No, so it went missing there. Then.
I'm worried about phenomenal or anything.
Oh yes? How is it it's possible to worry about non-phenomenal? How you worry about one that you can't perceive? I'm worried about that one. Yes. What are you worried about? If you're not worried about phenomena, then
I don't know.
I have never seen anybody suffer without knowing. You might be the first.
Really?
Then you can't be suffering. You know you are suffering? To suffer, you have to know something. What is the message behind the suffering?
That it's not strong, not like before, it is not very strong or anything, but why is it? I'm not able to describe that. I feel like, God, I don't know.
Why?
No, not why, I'm sorry.
Is it? No, I understand. Why is it that I'm not able to discover that?
No. Why is it?
No, it's okay. See, because sometimes it can seem like it's not a strong message, but if it's making, apparently making you suffer so much, then better to let it out. The truth, what happened? Only from the truth, what? Oh, you tell her if that helps, like yesterday.
now you're
used to school.
No, I'm not scared to talk to you like that. There is nothing in the life to suffer, make things or anything, but this has been going on for the truth for long, how many, I don't know, like, it is giving so, nothing else. Don't need anything else.
You only want the truth. Correct? Yes? You only
it's
want the
not
truth.
That. No, I can't say it is not me. Only it is.
For so many years, there's just been a wanting for the truth.
That
time. It's good to look like this because when you put your concepts under a microscope, sometimes it feels a bit uncomfortable, but actually it's very helpful, you see, it takes out the thorn. When we say things out like this, then it can feel a bit like strong or something like that, but sometimes when you're pulling out the thorn, it itself feels like it pains more. When it's embedded, then you feel like, okay, we got used to it. Sometimes looking out, you see, it feels like, but I was fine before this, you see. This is the thing. So what I'm hearing is that I have been searching for the truth for a very long time. Why am I not getting it? Keeping all the Advaita and fancy spirituality aside, this seems to be at the crux of it, is it? So,
no, I can't even say no, I want or something, but I can't say I don't know.
When you say I can't say, are you talking
Sorry,
about,
yeah.
No, it's fine, just we can talk openly, I'm just asking. When you say that I can't say, are you speaking about just the outward saying, but inwardly still some belief can go? Or when you say I can't say, like what you're saying is that there is no belief going to the seeker, there is no belief going to the journey, to the spiritual attainment.
Nothing, only that word.
Which
that
one?
Is only one came
Which
down.
One?
No.
Which one?
I can't say anything. There is something I don't know.
How do you know there is something? Do you perceive something? You are thinking something? What do you mean by there is something?
I'm not getting, or you know, like
a subtle feeling that some point is being missed, like that? Yeah? Like not the point,
no,
something is being missed.
Point before, yeah, now a bit clear, but whether I'm using concept or
let's look at it. Don't worry. So first, don't worry. You want to worry?
Okay.
Huh? No. Yeah.
No, please, you have to guide. I'm nothing in this person. Oh, sorry.
Hey, don't worry. Can you tell me at which layer of your existence are you suffering? What are you? Is it something you say? Everything in life is also okay. You see, so it's not from life events. Let's go one by one.
That occasionally.
Occasionally, but that is not.
This is the one.
Yeah, primarily it is not something that is in front of your eyes. Let's say that way, no, not in front of these eyes. Okay. So not at the realm of this perception. Then are you suffering from body pain? Is it about the body? No. Then is it about some other sensation that you had, but is lost, you see? Is it about some sensational thing like that?
Yeah, I just keep coming in.
So this idea that this some inner perception or inner sensation which was there is now changed or it is lost. Is that the cause of your suffering? Yeah. So were you calling the presence of that sensation or the presence of that perception, were you calling that as something special or freedom or something like that? Or a connection or something like this? The presence of some perception. You see? So, if that was being called the truth, you see? Then the truth does not come in. That's what I'm saying. So, I don't want any of the Sangha members to take any perception, any sensation, anything, even if it feels like the best spiritual experience that we can have. I don't want us to confuse that for the truth. You see, what is important even in this, you see, is who is aware of that perception. Who is aware of even that perception? Sublime spiritual experience though it might have been. You see? But for that which is aware of that perception, there is no difference between sublime and constriction. You see? There is no expansion or contraction for that. There is no connection or disconnection. You see? So anytime you put on the mask of that one for whom a particular perception was relevant or in this case seemingly important, you see, then you are putting on the mask of the false one, even though we may not realize it. You see, you are that which remains untouched by the coming and going of a million universes. You see, that which remains untouched by the coming and going of millions of universes. You cannot be hankering after some fireworks, let's call it provisionally, or some sublimity, or if there's a word like that. You see? So Anything that can go, let it go. Which means that anything that has come can be allowed to let go. We are allowed to let go of it. In fact, we must allow it to go. Don't make anything a thing. You realize? I used to say at one point, I've said, in 5-6 years, I've said at least 200 things which are my highest pointing. But at one point, I used to say, my highest pointing is don't make anything a thing. See? Now we made this something into a thing. You see? And when that thing changes its complexion, changes its fragrance, then we feel like we lost it. You see, but that which comes and goes, no matter what it is not a thing. Not a thing means don't attach to it. Don't give it your allegiance. Don't take it to be real. Because it's just a coming and going. You see, when it came, was it even there in deep sleep state? It can be only like that in if there's a mental fantasy. No, but in deep sleep state, everything goes. Everything. And if you have the fallacy that some dark empty space remains, even that is not true. It is just our memory, which is a repository of past, seemingly past experiences, stores up the few moments before sleep and few moments after sleep, and then it says, okay, this is the constant that was there. But sleep is not sitting in dark empty room for 6 hours or 8 hours. Then who wouldn't want to go to sleep? If somebody told you that, they would sound like solitary confinement or a punishment. But everybody wants to go to sleep. If you're not getting sleep, then that is causing trouble. You see? But if it was solitary confinement, you can't even see anything, you see? In this dark cave, then nobody will want to go there. It is the absence of all perception. Even the primordial beingness returns to its source. So you are given license, after coming to satsang, given license only to attach to that which does not come and go. And may, if you have an attachment to something that will come and go, may it go fast. It sounds like a harsh blessing. May it go fast. You see, especially if it is spiritual experiences. You see, because I've seen as much joy as they bring, they also bring, in their wake, they also bring enough suffering. Because there is enough possibility to take yourself to be the false and attach to this. Just forget about it. I am not saying that they are a bad thing. That's why I use the metaphor of prasad. When a sublime spiritual experience is happening, enjoy it to be the prasad of your darshan. Of the truth. You see? But if you confuse the prasad to be the darshan, then it's going to cause a lot of trouble. Suppose you visited some place and you had the darshan of the Supreme Lord. You had an insight of the Supreme Lord. Then after that insight, somebody came and gave you a laddu. You know, laddu is this round Indian sweet. Right? He came and gave you a laddu. And you started to mistake the laddu for the Supreme Lord. What will the master come and tell you? Don't mistake the Laddu for the Lord. But this is what spiritual experiences do. We mistake the fragrance of joy and bliss and peace. And we take that to be the real, and we neglect that for which all of these things were just byproducts. Love, peace and joy are in service to your true self. You are not in service to them. All perceptions are in service to your reality. You are not in service to them. Whatever may come, and this is very well illustrated in this, what I call the Arjuna conundrum. The Arjuna conundrum is very, very beautiful, but because it signifies the life of a spiritual seeker very beautifully. See? So what is it? So this seeker, because he can not yet relate to the Lord in the unmanifest form, so in the Lord, in the Lord's grace, appeared to him as Krishna in the manifest form, as his best friend, as his best friend actually. You see, Krishna is there, the Lord in the manifest form. You see, now the nature of the mind is what? You see, like, can you? And before we get there, this Lord in the manifest form is pointing Arjun to the truth of the unmanifest, that which is deathless. He said very clearly, Krishna has told Arjun that that which comes and goes is not real. Nothing real ever is born or dies. He explained all this thing to him. So, and yet, even after being pointed to that which is beyond form, beyond perception, what is Arjuna's request? Show me your darshan in your grand form, Virat Roop. Then the Lord in his compassion, or maybe he just wanted to get on with the war, said, okay, I show you. You see, because you're still clamoring for a phenomenal experience. Here you go. So he sees, Arjun sees Krishna, I am bigger than a universe, with all these beings coming and going inside his mouth, you see, planets and universes and all of the most magnificent that you can imagine, you see. Then what happened? Did Arjun get enlightened? Arjun was enlightened only much later in his life. So this is the thing. Now suppose Arjun got attached to that experience. You see? Ah, this is what always should be. You see? Then the story would not have continued. It would have just been in that stupor. But when you meet a sage, do you see, meet a sage like this? He's just in a stupor. Or she's just in a stupor. Day-to-day life seems to be playing out. You see? So, what you want is already there with you. You're being pointed to that which is your deathless, formless reality. You see? Which is beyond any perception, even if it is the most sublime, even if the mind is screaming saying, but that was it, it cannot be. Because if it is gone, it is clear it cannot be. If it came, it is clear it cannot be. You see? But in this Arjuna conundrum, it really helps us clarify what is it that we actually want. You see? We wanted to meet God in a phenomenal aspect because we were not yet able to relate to the formless, our own divine presence. So Guruji appeared in our life. You see? Guruji appeared in our life. He's pointing us to our formless reality, timeless reality. But what can we do? Either we can follow and meet ourselves in that way, or we can ask for something more phenomenal or something that came that we thought was it. You see? And this is not an uncommon thing. I've met hundreds in the past 5-6 years who have come with this, but I had awakening or I had freedom 3 years ago, and then it was so clear that all of this is one. You see? And then I lost it. You see? And then, just like chasing the dragon, you see, what are we doing? Everything that you are finding in satsang, you are comparing against that benchmark. You see? Everything. So, that's why one day I was so irritated. No? I just said, but fresh God is here. You see? Fresh God is here. You are missing it for some stale God in your head. You see? Fresh God means that which is. Both the manifest and the unmanifest. You see? Is here. But we are like, no, but that one. You see? This God is a bit insipid. You see? It's not that exciting, that glorious. That one. You see? A fresh God is here. All this light and color and sound and you see, eyes and so much beauty, all of the but here I am. You see, we miss God, chasing God. That is the irony of it. And God help us if we are strongly fixated on some idea of God. Then we cannot meet God fresh. No? Strongly fixated that God has to be like that, like Arjun. So God is standing in front of him, God is sitting inside him. Both ways God, God. He is saying, show me God. Is he? So what to do? Is it purely intellectual?
No.
No, good.
No, you will chop.
Yeah.
Okay. So as you are saying about sleep and
yeah.
So I was just trying to see, very honestly, like who goes into sleep.
Yes, good.
So the one who is saying I,
yeah.
He plus his conditioning and etc.
Yeah.
Everything goes away in the
yes.
sleep state.
Yes.
So when I am waking up,
yes.
And I am seeing,
yeah.
Not phenomenally realizing or knowing that this believer plus his conditioning is all doing the business here.
Yes.
So this is just I just came to know.
Yes.
And this is the one who is stuck with the
yeah.
world plus sometimes worldly activity, sometimes spiritual activity.
Yes.
And he is the one who is actually believing everything.
Correct. Yeah,
who is
exactly.
he? And I just want to it is almost like a inference,
yeah.
But that can confirm also because he is. I am not there in the sleep.
Yes.
If I have to say
yes.
that way.
Yes.
But I am here.
Very good.
So if I have to use the word therefore, but then
yeah.
it will be an inference.
Yeah.
But that is what my experience.
Yeah. It's very good. It's very good. Because these are the things which come out of your insight. You see something, I am not there in my sleep state. You see, another way we could say it in satsang is that even the sense I am is not there in the sleep state. You see, because you are there to confirm that I am not there. You see, like to say I am not there, like to say that this wall vanished, you see, and then it came back. You have to be there in both, no? How will you say the wall vanished unless you saw that it vanished? But you did not see with these eyes. You see, that's where it becomes very subtle. So to be able to say, but in the sleep state, I was not there. You see, are you just making it up? No. You see. Are you speaking the truth? Yes, it is my own seeing. You see, so the one who can see that must have been there to see it, but it is not seeing with these eyes. That's why it becomes very confusing. You see? So, you were not there, no, in sleep state. Confirm. Yes. So, it is confirmed only because you were there to confirm that I am is not there.
But in this case, like, so for example, I was not there
yes.
in that cricket match. I did
yes.
not go there.
Yes.
So I did not saw it.
Yes, but then you cannot say that there was a cricket match.
Yeah.
You see? So because you are able to see it, there is, I am saying, not from a third party report, like a newspaper report or something. You see, I am telling you definitely I was not there. You see, then did you read about it in a newspaper? No. Did somebody tell you you were not there? No. You saw, but not with these eyes. You were aware. You see, that's why the word aware comes. You were aware that you were not there. So that awareness is a constant. You see, in the absence of all perception and in the absence of the substratum of all perception, which is the sense I am itself, you are. You see, otherwise the word sleep, suppose there was one more state. You see, sometimes jokingly I say Super Turiya level 7. You see, which everybody goes to. You see, but nobody is aware there. You see? Then it is just in the level of speculation. You see? So if I tell you, you went to Super Turiya level 7 last night, or you'll say, if you're in a good mood, you'll say, okay, okay, Ananta, because you're saying, I'll believe you. That is the best, no? But you can't confirm it. You see? But if I say, you didn't go to sleep last night, you'll say, no, Ananta, I did. I woke up, no, at 7 o'clock or whatever, 6 o'clock. You see? So there's a difference between the two. The difference is that you have a very, very direct insight, beyond even direct insight, just a pure awareness of sleep. But, you see, it is not in the realm of perception. Therefore, to the mind and the intellect, it is very confusing. You see, you have to meet it with the innocence of a child. Did you sleep last night, beta? Yes. I woke up, you know, just in time for school, like that, you see. But you went to sleep, no? Yeah, like that, simple, like that. But if you try to understand it, it's not understandable, because our tools in this world are made for phenomenal qualities, you see? Made for phenomenal things. Like the mind will only interpret phenomena, the intellect will only judge phenomena, our attention will only go to phenomena. You see, all the tools are phenomenal tools. You see? So, our belief can only go to a phenomenal concept, a concept about some phenomena. You see? Or actually, the concept itself is phenomena, even if it is posing as if it is representing the non-phenomenal. You see, so all our tools are phenomenal. You see, but your recognition about yourself is empty of the need for any tool. You see? So what happens in like a guided inquiry, or when we sit together and look, is that just you're putting your tools down. Putting the tools down. That is what is happening. You're trying to you're trying to cut space with a knife. So guided inquiry, keep the knife down. You're trying to measure the universe with the kitchen weighing scale. So then keep the weighing scale away. You're trying to fit God into our minds. It's just like that. Trying to measure the universe with the kitchen weighing machine. How many kilograms of universe is there? But when you let go of these tools, the truth is that apparent to you that you don't have to measure anything then. You don't have to hold on to anything there. It's not a new thing that you are getting. This can be a big confusion. When you are open and empty, you are not presented some new thing. In a strange way, you are just introducing that which always is to yourself. other, when desires come up, I get a sense that I need to resist them and stay open and empty. Could you please clarify? So let's clarify really deeply. What are we calling a desire firstly? A desire means that a set of sensations or a set of perceptions must be there to be experienced. Is that valid? What is a desire? Like that, no? Basically. So let's see, we're deconstructing together. So if some insight is coming to you, you can also say it. But when we are looking, so what is desire? Let's not just take a term desire and just use it generically, right? What we are really saying is that there's an idea about a set of perceptions or sensations, which if it is not there, then I want it to be there, and if it is there, then I don't want it to go. Shall we look at it like that? Is that what a desire would be? And
there's a lack of it.
Either there's a lack of it not there, so I want it to be perceived, I want it to be present with me, and if it is there, then I don't want it to be taken away. Even that is a desire, isn't it? That something is there, now it should not leave. That's also a desire, isn't it? Because the absence of that perception is then an aversion. Like I would be averse to leading or seeing a world or a state in which that perception, that sensation would be absent. And aversion also then can mean that a certain idea about some set of sensations or perceptions which I have should not come, because there's that is also an aversion, you see. So that is what a desire is, you see. Now and importantly, it is an idea about what should be or what should not be. It's an idea about what should be or what should not be. You see, we are not talking about like if there's a feeling, or there's like the feeling that we could call longing or something like that, that can come. You see, and we are not even talking about the natural feeling of hunger or lust or any of these things, because they can also naturally just come and dissipate. You see, we are not judging any of that also. Right? All of that, anger, hunger, lust, all this can also come. You see? So all of this can be there. You see? Now, when we take that natural perception, or even without that natural perception, if we are making a judgment saying this should be or this should not be, you see? Let's say that that is what desire is, provisionally at least. We can explore further. Now, when we say open and empty seems like a resistance to that, that is not what is being said at all, you see, because just, it's not that you idea, you should go, because then that will become another aversion. Idea is there, and the idea that something should not be is what we are calling an aversion or a desire in another way, you see. So we are definitely not to resist this desire with another desire that now you should not be, isn't it? So then what is being suggested when we are saying open and empty? What is being suggested is that let all of these ideas, they come and go. You see, you're not to resist them, you're not to say you should not be, none of that. Very naturally, very organically, the idea will appear and it will disappear. If there is some sensational movement along with that, allow that sensation also to just naturally play out. We are not talking about trying to control anything that is coming up in this play of perception, in this world of appearances. You see? So to be open and empty is not to become the traffic policeman. You see? It is to just allow all the traffic to flow naturally, because you don't have to cross the road, or you don't have to board any of the buses or trucks or cars. It doesn't matter what comes and goes. You see? So don't look at being open and empty as some sort of a resistance, because resistance would mean that you have to stop the flow of traffic or you have to only direct a certain set of traffic, you see, but you don't have to do any of that, you see, that would be a resistance. Having said all of that, it is also apparent that initially to not, because we got so used to, it's like we lived in the middle of the road, right, coordinating all this traffic, or we've been a traffic policeman for 20 years, you see, then you've just retired from that job, see, but you see a traffic jam about to form, what is your tendency? You will want to jump in and resolve it, right? So that is the extent of effort that is needed, you see, to recognize that you are retired now, you are no longer the traffic policeman, it is not your problem to try and fix it. If that seems like effort, then that much effort is okay, because actually it is non-effort, you see, but for us it can seem as if it is effort. Just like ignorance or maya or avidya can seem to be the truth. So, okay, so there's a further on that. When desire comes up, it seems like there is a choice to take action to fulfill or not fulfill that. And being open and empty seems to suggest we don't take any action to fulfill. That's why I'm saying that all of the instruction, all of the pointing is not meant for your representation of yourself as a body-mind. You see? Because once you take yourself to be that, then everything gets very confusing anyway. You see? So it's not for your representation of yourself as body-mind. And one of the fallacies that I use to take yourself to be a body-mind is the fallacy of cause and effect. Is the fallacy that thought leads to action. No, only consciousness leads to everything. It is not cause and effect. The only cause, if you have to, in our intellect, fit cause and effect, then the only cause is consciousness and the only effect is consciousness. Put consciousness there, then that whole paradigm dissolves, you see. But if we get caught up in these ideas of this, therefore that, this leading to that, you see, then we put ourselves in this linear sort of life, then obviously we will take ourselves to be something in time and space, you see. That's why in the Yoga Vaisheshika, the sage has given us a very simple example, you see. But most actually miss this example, you see. They read it and they're like, what? How is this? You see, what is the example? The example is that the bird flies and lands on the branch of the coconut tree. The coconut falls. You see? Simple example like that. So, what will the mind make out of that? It is because the bird landed on the branch of the tree that the coconut fell. But does anyone really know that? You see, maybe it was time for the coconut to fall anyway. And the landing of the bird. Now I'm over describing, it will spoil your inquiry, you see. But the bird landed. We can't really say it led to something else. And again, it is not something fresh that I'm saying. Philosophers, spiritualists, masters for thousands of years, I've tried to explore this idea of cause and effect, and nobody has come to any authoritative conclusions about these things. You see? That's why I'm saying that even if you believe in these things, even if you believe in the idea of karma and things like this, as long as you're saying that they are the rules of this apparent play or this appearance, it is fine that way. But if you say it applies to reality, to the truth, that's when confusion can come. Then next one says, as Guruji says, the witness is not involved in the crime scene. Yes. Beautiful metaphor. The witness is not involved in the crime scene. Next one says, Beloved Anantaji, I want to look with you about suffering from inferiority. Even to look, it feels little shame actually. This is the concept for a long time. I am hanging out with... It's just like sometimes it all looks like word soup. I mean, because the font is really small. Even to share it feels like a little shame actually. This is the concept for a long time I am hanging out with Acha. And somehow, today I come to see that in actuality, I cannot suffer from it. But I see that a lot of reaction goes on in the mind about how people to me, what they say, how they say, etc. So may you please bring some light on it. So let's look at this. I want to look with you about suffering from inferiority. Like inferiority complex, no? People say that they always feel like I'm not worthy, I'm not deserving, the other one is better than me. It's also, there's got various names, no? Some even call it imposter syndrome. So one time there was a great musician. He was invited to a party by another good musician. This one was a greater musician. Story. So, but then this great musician could not be in that party of other musicians because his mind kept telling him, but you're nobody, you don't belong here. Your music is the worst. These people are all great. So it's like this feeling of imposter syndrome. I don't deserve it. I am not worthy. It's a form of inferiority complex. And this is, if you apply the spiritual seeker context to it, this becomes really like an obstacle because we feel like, but who am I to get freedom? There are people who've been meditating for 100 years. You see, I just started my spiritual journey 2 years ago. Who am I to get freedom? What makes me worthy? Like this kind of idea. So one is this suffering from inferiority. Clearly, what we are talking about is taking ourselves to be something that we are not. You see, we are obviously not talking about inferior awareness and superior awareness. We are talking about inferiority complex of this body mind. You see, and all these conditions, all these ideas that we take about this body is the condition. You see? Is the condition. So some few can also have superiority complex. You see? They come into any situation, they're like, who are these foolish people? Maybe someone conditioned themselves that way. You know? Like Winston Churchill used to say, when I'm talking to a bunch of people, I just think that they're little children. Or like the biggest fools on earth. Or something. Like that, you see, like this. But some can have this sort of superiority complex conditioning. So inferiority complex or superiority complex, I would say that in your investigation into who you are, then all of this can't really survive because all of this belongs to conditions about taking yourself to be something that you are not, taking yourself to be the body mind. So that is quick camp. But let's look further. Even to share it feels a little bit of shame actually. This is the concept for a long time I am hanging out with. And somehow, today I come to see that in actuality, I cannot suffer from it. But I see that a lot of reaction goes on in the mind about how people, let's say, how people who matter to me, what they say, how they say it, etc. So suppose I matter to you. Now you are in tenterhooks. Some of it is natural. You see? Some of it is natural. Like if I was sitting in front of Guruji. You see, like that, it can feel like. You see? So sometimes we are also very harsh on ourselves. If some natural feeling is there, let it be. Little bit is okay. But unless we are just constantly in that fear, I hope this one doesn't tell me this, I hope this one doesn't say this, I hope my friend talks to me properly, I hope my mother is good to me, all of this is like become obsessive. You see? And then I won't say that we have to deconstruct too much or we have to really look very deeply at it. You see? So, stay with what you're hearing in satsang. Let go of any remnants of this false identity. Let go of all representations that you may be making about yourself. You see? Because once you put on this mask of being separate, you see, then what we are talking about is more in the realm of self-help and this kind of phenomenal sort of thing. You see? You empty yourself from this identification and then tell me if there's like a natural sense of any of this. Don't take yourself to be anything limited. Then how will all of these things even play out? So what am I saying? I'm basically saying, like, one time I saw in Rishikesh, you see, one man who was selling medicine in these small bottles. It was red color medicine. You know? So whatever your ailment was, he would give you these bottles, charge 10 rupees and this. You see? So satsang is like that. Whatever your ailment may be, you know by now that what you are going to be pointed to is the truth of what you are. Because if you keep playing this game of supposing what you are and trying to resolve it at that level, then at best it is only a temporary band-aid. You see? It is only a temporary fix. You see? But the true affliction is not getting fixed there. It's only symptomatic fixing that's happening. You see? It's like if you have an infection in the body which is leading to a headache, you see, some medicines will only work on the symptom. Like you will not feel the pain of the headache. But the infection might even continue to fester actually, might be becoming worse. You see? So satsang is that which attacks the infection itself. You see, which is the false identity, which is then the fertile ground for all these other symptomatic seeming problems. And I feel like in your heart that's what you want. Then next one says, thank you Father. So leave consciousness to consciousness. Yes. It's a good provisionally it's very good. You see? But I would say to you, leave the leaving of consciousness to consciousness to consciousness. You see, and recursively we can keep going. So leave the leaving of consciousness to consciousness also to consciousness. You see, but what am I saying? I'm saying really just leave the lever also. Don't forget to leave the lever. Like Guruji says, don't forget to surrender the surrenderer. Otherwise that identity can still remain. Oh, I have now left consciousness to consciousness. But leave that I have, the one who has now left consciousness to consciousness. Okay. Thank you all so much for being in Satsang today. Sadhguru Shimuji Baba ki Jai.
Sadhguru Shri Ananda Ji ki
Jai.
Guru Kripa Kevalam.